it had to start with me. That the Lord had to work in me to work on how I was going to love Guy. Because regardless of whatever Guy did or didn't do, even if he was sinning, it did not mean that I had to sin. And so I had to start being humble and saying, okay, Lord, trying to fix him isn't working. You've got to start fixing me.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, it's pretty normal for marriages to experience the ebb and flow of relationship. You have those beautiful days, those wonderful moments, and then you have the maybe not so wonderful moments like, do I have to tell you again where the milk is?
Or I'm so sorry.
Or worse, but the irritating things, right? Here's some encouragement from the book of Hebrews. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Maybe not you or your spouse, but Jesus is, and that's something to stand on. No matter what things look like with your spouse today, rest in the fact that we have an unchanging God who is willing to comfort you and help you and transform your marriage. Today, we're going to bravely trudge into some areas that might be a little uncomfortable, the triggers in your marriage. Every marriage has them, and all of us need God's help to get through those things and kind of mature so those triggers don't trigger us, right? Mm-hmm. And I've asked Jean, my wonderful wife and accountability partner, to be here with us today.
I think it's wonderful that we have Jean along with us. And Guy and Amber Lia are relationship coaches and co-owners of a faith and family production company in Los Angeles. And they've been married 14 years and have four boys. And they've written a book together called Marriage Triggers, Exchanging Spouses' Angry Reactions for Gentle Biblical Responses. And we have that here at the ministry. Give us a call or click the link on your screen.
Welcome, each and every one of you.
Thank you. We are so glad to be here.
Now, I'm really looking forward to this. I think it's one of the core communication issues in marriage. How do we not trigger each other? How do we better understand those triggers? And we're going to get into that. Guy and Amber, you came up with the idea, so let's start with you. You describe your marriage as triggered from the start. That sounds a little frightening. Why was that the case? And didn't you enjoy a little bit of a honeymoon period?
Well,
who's going first? Yeah. Who wants to put their hand
up? Emphasis on the word little. We had a little bit of a honeymoon period, but not very long.
Things moved very, very quickly for us. When we got married, and within a couple of months, we got pregnant. And so we didn't have that time to kind of develop ourselves and get to know our identity as a young married couple. We quickly shifted directly into parenting, and you know, the extra room that was going to be the fun room suddenly turned into the baby's room. And, you know, all that. My wife is a wonderful planner. And so she shifted into high gear planning mode and painting and all the things. Oh, yes. And I'm like, wait a minute. Like,
what about me? He was saying.
So is evidence of your growth the fact that you just said, she's a wonderful planner? It sounded so heartfelt.
Yeah. No.
Did it used to be like, man, she plans everything?
It still is. I'll admit that can still be a thing. Because
best foot forward.
Those are one of the differences we have in our relationship, is she very much is the planner, and she thinks 10 steps ahead. And I'm very happy thinking one or two steps ahead and being in the moment. And so we have to continually find that balance for ourselves.
So I get the baby part, but before that even, there were other stressors going on.
Yes.
For the newlyweds listening that may be going, oh my goodness, that's my wife or that's my husband. What were some of those other stressors?
Well, you know, they say opposites attract, and there is some truth to that, but it also creates a lot of everyday practical problems. And when you're in a friendship and dating, and then you get married, living with one another is a different beast.
Really?
And, you know, it was even early on just with, for example, we would, I wanted to put in our new apartment a wall of portraits, you know, our wedding photo, and, you know, make room for when baby comes and all of that, and the planner and me.
The big wall of pictures.
The big wall of pictures. And I thought, on a Saturday, this is going to be amazing. We will all lay it all out. We'll do all the measuring. Guy will do all the hammering. And he
run,
woke up
Guy,
like,
run.
He woke up ready to watch the football game, you know,
what?
And he was like, whoa,
excellent
wait
choice.
A minute here.
It was the Notre Dame USC football game, and that's what I had planned.
The game.
I had planned for weeks for that day.
I know, that's right.
How could you plan that during the SC Notre Dame game?
I just had different perspectives. perspectives on what was important at the time. And because we didn't at the time have the communication skills to work through those things together, which we want to offer people hope that that is possible. At the time, we weren't doing that. We were just triggered and easily provoked to anger. And so we were reacting instead of responding to each other. And it kind of went downhill from
there. Did either of those things happen then? Did the wall get the pictures or did the game get watched?
Yes.
The wall got done and the game got watched part of it. So,
but neither of us were very happy about either place.
It ended up in the book, so it still exists as one of those days that was a pivotal day for us.
Yeah, well, and you both became convinced that you'd married the wrong person.
Yeah.
Okay, tell us about that.
That's a big statement.
Yeah. Yeah. I married Mr. Wrong for sure. Mm-hmm. And he married Ms. All Wrong. I mean, we got it all wrong. And I used to think, well, I believe in God's sovereignty, but boy, this was a mistake. I mean, I really felt that way early on. Even though I loved him, and a lot of the time I liked him, we had so many triggers that I wondered, how is this going to happen? How are we going to navigate this for the rest of our lives? Mm. And it wasn't until God started working on me personally, after I nagged and argued and yelled for a really long time, and that didn't work, the Lord eventually started to say, Amber, you are Ms. All Wrong, and he's Mr. Wrong, but that's because nobody is perfect. There is no perfect person except for Jesus Christ. And so as long as you continue to be prideful and argue, you are not going to live life to the full or have the marriage that I designed. Because the minute that you say I do, you do become a match made in heaven. And so that's what I had to come to. It was like, you know what? We made a vow. God did bring us together. He is wrong, I'm wrong, but that's because we're two people that are sinful. We need to yield to being perfected in Christ day by day. And that's what's going to make us right for each other.
You know, Amber, as you describe that, one of the things that certainly Gene and I have encountered, I think you and Dina, John, have probably encountered this too. It's hard to, if I could say it this way, get your fingers out of your ears. Because I think we get into the habit in our marital relationships where the more pain you're causing me, the more trigger you're causing me, the harder I stuff my fingers into my ears because I don't want to hear it. And it is the exact opposite of what the Lord wants from you, right?
Yeah, the pain acts as blinders, you know. It filters us to not being able to hear or see each other.
Yeah, and that is a fork in the road in your relationship. You got to decide if that's where you want to live in that constant conflict.
Amber came up with this wonderful principle that I think is one of the pivotal things in our book and in our marriage is the development of a me first attitude. And at first thought, that sounds like prideful, me first, right. I want to get what I want. It's actually the flip of that. It's the, if I want my wife to be more loving, then I need to start with me and I need to be more loving. If I want to be, I want her to be more understanding and compassionate about my needs, I need to show her that compassion and the understanding of her needs first, be first, and it changes everything.
Well, that's a good foundation. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously. Let's go to some of the triggers in the book, because I want to hit those.
Yes.
And you're going to come back next time, because we're going to keep this discussion going. And Gene wants to tell the world about all of my, you
know, stuff. It'll be a separate but
she's got quite a list over there.
I see the list. It's going to the floor there. One of the things, Amber, you identified with, and Gene said, that's one for me too, is when the house is a mess, that's a trigger.
It is.
How is that a trigger? I mean, are Guy and I triggering this, and you and Gene? Or
you know, it's a combination of things, and it you know, every marriage is unique, right? Because you've got two unique personalities, and that's going to make up a unique marriage personality. But for a lot of couples, we found that one or the other is more bothered by clutter or dirtiness, you know, which are two different things. Sometimes the house is very clean. Wives will tell their husbands when they, you know, are come in after being gone from work or whatever, and we'll say the house is clean, it's just cluttered.
That's
messy. But those are two different things. I'm trying really hard here. But so for Guy and I, you know, he's not as bothered or triggered by clutter as I am. And when you're home a lot, like I was with our kids when they were young, a lot of couples will tell us this is such a problem. And so I had to disrupt that habit of being reacting, being quick to anger. And, you know, I believed God when he said, be slow to anger, you know, be quick to listen. And I had to say, okay, deep breath. what can we do together to tackle this? You know, put some things in place, communicate. Part of it was just me practically having to get some better storage bins for the mess, teaching the kids to take on a little bit more responsibility. But if that's your biggest trigger, you know, don't get overwhelmed by the 10 triggers that you have, but take one at a time. And we would do that. We're like, look, the constant clutter is not working for me. What can we do to strategize together? I don't want to keep reacting. I want to be more proactive.
If I can say from my side of things, you know, I was working a really intense job where I'd be at work 10, 12 hours a day, and I'd come home and Amber's got, you know, two or three or four kids at home. At this time, it was three kids, two of them still in diapers. And I'd come home and could barely open the door because there's like toys all over the floor, you know, and I'm walking into that going like, I just got off work and I should come into a house that's clean and ready and, you know, and I'd be frustrated or I wouldn't say anything.
Yeah, that
was
not a good stage.
And I would allow that trigger to kind of bubble up in me and it would immediately push me towards frustration and anger right away. But I just think that you have to have an understanding of what your spouse, what their day is like and what they're going through. And again, it goes back to that me first attitude a little bit. When you are concentrated on yourself, thinking about what your attitude is going into something, I think you can get a better understanding of what you're walking into with your spouse.
And he would do that. Also, he would call me on the way home from work. He got in the habit of doing that just to kind of get a lay of the land, a feel for the environment he was walking into so he could prepare himself mentally to walk into that. That's one thing we did.
I'd take a moment either in traffic or right out in front of the house while in the car, just, how's it going? What am I walking into?
What do you need help with?
Just so I know.
When I would call home, if Dina said, what do you want? I knew that I was walking into something.
Yeah, exactly.
Sounds more like military communication. We got four zombies in there. Yeah. Look out when you come in the door.
Yes, yes.
I mean, that's
prepare
crazy.
Yourself for the landmines.
Okay, well, that was very good of the ladies on this house being clean thing. Now, let's go to a guy one.
Guy.
Yeah. When it comes to us being triggered, maybe backseat driving. I mean, I'm terrible at that.
Yeah.
Right, Gene? I'll confess it.
Me too.
I can be a backseat driver.
Absolutely. But we...
She didn't hesitate much there.
No, but we've worked through that.
Good. I'm glad. Yeah. That one's off the... Okay, let's move on to the next trigger.
Yeah, we need to talk about it.
Guy, there was early in your marriage, you had a driving experience, I think, with the two of you. What happened? And we'll respond.
Yeah, we were... Well, you know, so we live in Los Angeles, and it is just crazy. It is fill every hole. It's traffic for hours. It's just nuts. Yeah. And on this particular evening, we were driving back. It had rained a little bit, and I was changing lanes, and someone in front of me just changed right in front of me and caused me to have to, you know, jerk the wheel to get out of the way. And Amber immediately was like, Guy, what are you doing? You shouldn't drive like that. And it was this immediate like lash out at me. And I'm like, it wasn't me, it was him. And I'm trying to be defensive and take care of this.
Yeah, let me ask you this question. If you didn't swerve, would you have been hit?
Oh, absolutely.
Probably.
Okay, clearly
I'm on your side on this one,
clearly.
Guy.
I am now.
However,
I wasn't hit, but I am now.
Yes.
The principle is, and we didn't necessarily work it out that night as successfully, but
and
a
guys
little
being
while
nice,
later,
because the truth is, this was a habit of mine. I mean, it wasn't just when we were in danger.
Yeah.
I was always telling him how to drive. I admit that.
Yeah. But... what I was able to do is to think the best about my wife and realize that she wasn't lashing out at me and my bad driving. She was actually lashing out at her sense of safety for our four kids that were in the back seat most of the time. So she being the mama bear, her concern was safety for them. And so that's where her frustration was coming from. So I just had to realize that it wasn't towards me. It was literally about the situation, and it allowed me to accept her prompts
anxiety.
And anxiety and all that in a much different way. And it really changed. It still crops up from time to time. It's an organic thing. Marriage, you know, every day is different. So it still comes up
but
every once in a while.
But it required a conversation. I mean, one of the things that Guy and I did is, I mean, it was so constant that we were getting frustrated in the car. We were like, look, we're going to have to drive together a lot for the next however many years. We've got to figure this out. So I was like, okay, I'm going to focus on you. You're the driver. You focus on driving. I'm the passenger. I will work on being a passenger and not a driver. And I will try to allow my anxieties to take a backseat.
Yeah, but the question is, how did you control your tongue? That's what all of this is about,
this is,
right?
A couple things. Yeah. I'd bite my tongue, literally. I'm not kidding. I would just, like, bite my tongue. You know, like, okay, Amber, zip it. But We started listening to podcasts or books on tape just to distract me.
Were these instructional driving?
Yes. That
Focus on
that
family
was, see,
podcast,
we should come here
no
back
doubt.
Then.
Those calming videos, like, yes. Just picture the blue skies.
Make a right turn.
Water trickling. But honestly, like, it seems like a small thing, you know, being a backseat driver.
I get it.
But it really, the perpetual... you know, interjections of while someone's driving, mm-hmm. it gets to you. It just creates a layer of frustration that you may not even pick up on overtly. So now when Guy is driving, I'm in charge of the map and not in a, hey, turkey, you were supposed to turn there, which I still do.
That was a brave move, actually.
Yeah, but, you know, and letting him take the scenic route. You know, if he doesn't go the way I would go, it's okay. Hmm. Let it go.
That's good. And Amber, I can relate to this next trigger. Actually, I can relate to all the triggers, frankly. But,
oh, we're signing off. Thank you for joining Focus on the Family.
But in your book, you've mentioned that you've had a struggle with an intimacy idol in your relationship because you didn't feel loved. Tell us about that.
Yes, I had very many preconceived notions and expectations about what our marriage was supposed to look like. Mm-hmm. And for us, I thought it was going to be a lot of security financially, white picket fence, mm-hmm. Guy will go to work. I wanted to be a stay-at-home mom and work from home on occasion. And the Lord, you know, he's got all his plans for us are good, and they work together for good. But in those early years, I didn't think much of the plans that Guy was making for our family were good. And so I had this idol of, you know, closeness and intimacy that he was going to do things my way. We were going to be on the same page. And when that didn't happen, it caused me to become really bitter. And so no matter what Guy would say or do, he couldn't get it right.
Right.
And yes. That is a really dangerous place to be. And it's a painful place to be.
Well, and it sets up conflict, obviously. Jean, I just, you know, for people to understand your connection with this, what were you feeling? And I think it's rooted in expectations. That's
Absolutely.
What you started with.
Absolutely. That we have unrealistic expectations. And I would say, you know, the maybe the greatest thing that I've learned through marriage is that your spouse cannot read your mind. And I can remember being hurt that Jim couldn't read my mind. He didn't know everything that I expected. And if I had to tell him what I was expecting, that made me angry. And until I recognized that is so unfair. Only Jesus, only God can read our minds.
And I am not God.
Right.
I know that every day.
It's okay, and you should sit down with your spouse and during a season and say, okay, this is really what my expectations are for my birthday or for when you come home for work, or these are my expectations for when I come home from work, and how can we get
the
there?
The birthday one's funny. You should bring that up, because there was one birthday where Jean said to me, I just, you know, I'm not sure you can tell us all the motivation behind this, but said, you know, I really don't want anything for my birthday. I'm good this year, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Very,
yes.
Very crisp, bright attitude. I thought, oh, wow,
very
take some
selfless.
Pressure. So birthday comes, and, you know, we have dinner, and the next day I could tell she's not happy.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, what's the matter? You didn't even get me a card for my birthday.
Yeah.
I thought you said, what I heard
I
was
heard
you didn't want
different than you said, apparently.
I mean, anything is like a gift. It's a card. It's anything.
Right.
But that wasn't quite it.
No, and I still
swing
I remember,
and a miss.
I remember where we were when I said it.
Wow.
But,
yeah.
And what
have I
meant
said,
was.
Sorry?
What I meant, I'm
yes,
sorry.
Yes, you have. What I meant was I didn't want Jim to buy me a gift.
Yeah.
I didn't want Jim and the boys. But that didn't mean I didn't want homemade cards from the boys, you know, that I wanted a cake, I wanted, you know, dinner.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
She wasn't fully letting you off the hook.
What she didn't realize is she was actually giving the boys and I a gift,
a
day off of birthday. So we thought, wow, that is so kind of mom.
But
how
after
selfless.
That, I will say, I mean, truly, after that, I was able to say to Jim, okay, these are my expectations for my birthday.
Right.
It was, I want Can you work with the boys to make a handwritten cards?
Yeah. Now, you guys had this with Christmas, right? Your first or second Christmas?
Yes,
you had
our
a stocking
Christmas.
Battle?
Right. I mean, we were so excited we were going to do stockings. You say it, Guy.
Yeah, I was.
You did it.
So excited when she said she wanted to do stockings. I was really excited that was going to be a tradition in our family, because that was something that was a tradition that my family had. The night before Christmas, we would always get together and open the stockings, and it was so much fun. But our stockings would be filled with gag gifts and little funny things and just crazy stuff. And we'd do even a white elephant thing where you'd end up sending the bad gift around. And it was so much fun. Amber's stocking, for me, was filled with cologne and movie tickets and all this wonderful, you know, oils and different fun things. And it was...
I pulled out a red feather boa, and I was pretty sure that pulling that red feather boa out of my Christmas stocking, that we weren't going to make it to Christmas
the beginning
two.
Of the end.
Because I had been so thoughtful, all these favorite things in his stocking, valuable gifts, and I had just gag gift after gag gift, and I just thought, wow, we are really living in two different planets here. Yeah.
You know, Amber and Guy and Jean, I just, at the end here, I think it's important to really hone in on that idea of coveting the ideal marriage, having that high, impossible expectation, I guess, Amber, that you describe in your book. I want to, again, address that. Why is that really one of the most damaging things to a marriage?
When you have an idol in your thinking and you don't even realize it, because your spouse is not living up to your expectations, or your marriage, or your circumstances, the life that you've created is not the life that you hoped for and prayed for, you have a choice to make at some point in that moment. You can continue to be triggered and angry and bitter, and you can go down a path toward destruction, because Satan is alive and well, and he is seeking whom he may devour. And we're convinced that he was trying to devour us in those early years of our marriage. And even now, he still is on the attack. But the other option was to recognize that my desire for what I want is either going to become so obsessive that I sin if I don't have it. And that is an idol in my life, because I covet that more than putting on humility, a compassionate heart, kindness and forgiveness, and being open to trusting God with my marriage and my husband and my life. And so I had to tear down all those idols of what I wanted. And I had to start approaching Guy differently, and he had to start approaching me differently. And ultimately, we had to say, our lives are not our own. If I am so fixated on Guy's, you know, ability to make me happy or not, or my circumstances to be ideal, then I will always be miserable, because in this world I will have trouble. But Jesus says, fear not, for I have overcome the world. So I had to do a cleaning house of my idols and my thinking, and it had to start with me, that the Lord had to work in me to work on how I was going to love Guy, because regardless of whatever Guy did or didn't do, even if he was sinning, it did not mean that I had to sin. And so I had to start being humble and saying, okay, Lord, trying to fix him isn't working. You've got to start fixing me.
Well, Guy and Amber Lia are back with us today on Focus on the Family. Your host is Jim Daly. I'm John Fuller, and we're going to continue to help you learn how to de-escalate and have a more peaceful relationship with your spouse.
Let's get into it, Amber, with your love language. It's something Gary Chapman is the author of the Love Language book. He's been on Focus many times. It. He's a great friend. Mm-hmm. And you identify with words of affirmation.
Yes.
Jean, I think you would agree with that for you, right?
Sure.
Words of affirmation
Absolutely.
Is your core love language.
Right.
But you describe Guy as pretty much pathetic in that delivery mechanism of words of affirmation.
Right.
Is that fair, Guy? Did I over-dramatize
it? It's very fair.
I think, just to be honest, Jean might agree with Amber that I, too, am pathetic at delivering in that love language. Jean, do you want to affirm
that? Pathetic is so harsh, but...
There's room to grow. Room to grow.
What a good HR person you are. But that room to grow. So, Amber, describe that area where, you know, this is how you communicate. That's Gary Chapman's conviction on this. Is everybody's wired with a certain communication style, things that affirm your heart.
Yeah.
words of affirmation, right, or what affirm your heart, or what affirms Jean's heart. How did Guy let you down, and Jean, get ready, I'll come to you about how I've let you down.
Yeah, and you know, that book, Gary Chapman's ministry, was profoundly impacting on me early on in those early days of our marriage, because it gave me a concrete understanding of why some of these triggers were also taking advantage of our relationship, because we were not feeding each other in the way that we felt really truly loved. But early on, especially when I recognized that my love language was words of affirmation, Guy's is really acts of service. You know, he would just, I mean, our kitchen was sparkling. I mean, I never had to do a dish, and I loved that. But he just thought he was loving me so well, because I never had to dry a dish and put it away. I mean, and he was excellent. He's still excellent at that. I still don't do dishes to this day, really. I mean, he's so good at that. But I was just starving for that affection, and I couldn't understand why he wouldn't get with the program. And so,
did you ever talk that out? I mean, did you ever sit down?
I'm pretty sure that his book was the first book that was given to me by my wife.
Okay.
as it was actually the DVD set for the driving my 45-minute commute every day.
There's a hint.
But you know, we were so triggered for so long that we couldn't even get to the point where we were doing that really well for one another, giving each other what each other needed.
What was that turning point then?
Crisis. I'd come to a day where I was in so much pain in our relationship, and I just finally, it was just a God thing, where I came to the end of my tether, and I just said, I have to either do something radically different, or tomorrow's going to look just like today. And because my efforts in trying to fix my husband and be his Holy Spirit voice were not working, I knew the only person that I could control was myself. And so I just started with, Lord, I'm not sure what to do, but I know that you know what to do. Yes. And so I'm just going to be an open book. I need you to just cleanse me and show me what to do, think, and say, because I don't know what to do, Lord. It's in your hands.
I ironically had to, it's one of those situations where you see your wife walk by you and you think to yourself, wow, she looks absolutely stunning. But it stays in me and doesn't come out of my mouth to her.
Yeah. Right, you're having a conversation
and I do that a
in
lot.
Your head.
Yeah. And because for some reason, I just wasn't purposeful about getting that out and telling her what I was thinking in those moments. And that's what she needed, is she wanted to hear those things. I appreciate you. I appreciate what you did yesterday. Those kinds of things. And I just didn't verbalize it. So I found myself having to schedule in my calendar.
Yes, you did.
Twice a day, I would do a reminder in my calendar that just said, think Amber. And it would pop up. It would be a quick reminder on my BlackBerry at the time. And it would just say that. And it would be purposeful for me to call her and say something or to remember. And not that I did it all the time, but I needed a prompt to remind myself
great.
That she needed something.
It was okay. And honestly, for me, it didn't remove the meaningfulness of it, because at least he was working towards it. But I also had to come to a point where I decided I was either going to hold him to my standard, my expectation, or I was going to choose to see him the way that he does love me. So I did a switch in my brain, you know, through a lot of prayer. Lord, help me not to be so impacted by what he's not doing, speaking words of affirmation to me, and instead really look actively for the ways that he is showing you that he loves you, Amber. And so then I was able to let go. Like it doesn't impact me so much anymore that he doesn't compliment me. And God gave me two sons that are like really words of affirmation boys. And so, you know, we give that to one another in ample measure. Mm-hmm. And so Guy's kind of off the hook a little bit, but I just choose to see every day that he serves me.
This is something we still deal
That's
with.
How
I'll admit,
me.
Just I'm the other
it.
Night, just the other night, Amber has had a whiteboard that she wanted hung up in our office. And it's been sitting there for like 2 months.
Me and my house projects.
And we had a little bit of an argument. And instead of me dealing with it and apologizing to her and telling her, I hear you, I went and took care of that whiteboard. I put it up. I put it up in a room and it made sure that it was up and perfect and all great. And she didn't say anything that night. And the next day I was like, we were talking, things were a little bit better. And I was like, did you happen to see the whiteboard? You know, and it was my way of kind of, instead of verbalizing to her, I still did my act of service.
I
still fall. I still fall into that.
And I did feel the love in a way I wouldn't have in the past.
But I could have pulled her aside. Yes. I knew. I could have pulled her aside and had that conversation in the moment at that night.
Well, and
for
what
some reason, I still...
Yeah, and I've learned that, you know, if you argue over the project and then you do the project, it's only half credit.
Yeah, this is true. This is true.
You don't get an A, but you get a C. Now, Amber and Guy, you make a statement in the book where you're identifying a question that God often puts on both of your hearts during arguments and misunderstandings. Now, that's really spiritually sensitive that you can hear the Lord as you're arguing. That's far better than me. I usually have to calm down and then, okay, Lord, yeah, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say that. And I love what it is. Do you want to win the argument or do you want love to win? Mm-hmm. That is a beautiful starting point and one that most of us couples just blow right by.
Again, when you get to a place of brokenness and you say, God, I don't know what to do, but I need you to show me, he will show up for you. You can always count on God to be there to you. He hears our prayers. He hears the ache in your heart that you can't even put into words. Right. And that's where I was. And so I remember very vividly being at a point where Guy and I were in an argument. And I just remember this thought that came into my mind, Amber, do you want to win? Or do you want love to win? Because if you want to keep winning this argument, tomorrow's going to look just like today, and you're not living life to the full.
You know, Amber, the thing about that, it sounds right and true, and everybody just went, whew, yeah, that would be good. But then you got to do it.
That's right.
And that's the hard part. And why, I guess, two questions. One, why do we have that hesitancy? What becomes the obstacle in doing what is so right?
It's because we're not living out Colossians 3, 12 through 14. And at least for me, that was true, which says, you know, put on a compassionate heart with kindness, meekness, patience. And it says to bear with one another, right? Mm-hmm. Which means we're going to have to bear with each other through some of these triggers. And so what that looks like is me taking a deep breath instead of starting to na-na-na-na-na again. And literally I would stop. We've got to the practice of stopping in the middle of the wrong words and saying, I'm upset. I recognize it. I didn't mean to really say that. And I want to not say anything further that's going to be damaging. Let's take a break for a few minutes so that we can refocus on what it is that we want in our marriage, which is we want to be for each other. Mm-hmm. We want the marriage that God designed it to be. So we need to step away for a minute. We gave each other's permission. Hey, can we stop for a minute and go take a breather until we can calm down and have a conversation outside of conflict?
Right.
And we just got good at giving ourselves permission to do that. And then that did just take spiritual maturity. But that isn't that the point, you guys? Isn't the point for us, all of our relationships, to be about being refined?
Yes.
This life is not our own. If we start thinking, well, it's just about healing the marriage, it's not just about healing the marriage. This is about an eternal reward. This is about living and becoming more like Christ. And that's our end game. So we need to start doing things differently than we've been doing. And let's be forgiving each other just like Christ forgave us. And then we've got to start saying and doing things differently.
Well, and I think you're saying exactly what I believe is the purpose of marriage. Yes. You know, and the whole culture and the me orientation that we have is, what am I getting out of this? Almost like a contract.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It is so obvious that the Lord said, listen, I'm creating this institution so you can become more like me.
That's yes.
It. That's scary because that description is selfless.
It is.
Giving, kind, loving.
And learning to serve one another, which is not natural.
Right.
That's not natural.
It works against our flesh, but it's what the Lord wants. Mm-hmm. I think that is the whole answer to why marriage. Why did we do
this? And it might feel like, we always tell people, if it feels like the death of you to yield in that moment, then you're in the right place.
Yeah.
Because it should be the death of you. It's
exactly
the death to self.
Yes. Mm.
So if it feels like the death of you, that's the right place to be.
And it's so helpful just to pause, to give permission to pause and not try to solve the problem in the moment when the heat is going.
Let me transition a little bit and go to something that really caught my attention in the book. There was a point you said in your marriage when you realized you didn't have a foundation of friendship. Hmm. Okay. I believe most married people are leaning in right now when they've heard that, because there are seasons in marriage when you don't feel close. It's busy, it's kids, it's, you know, littles running around and pulling on everybody's time. But I guess the first question is, what made you realize that I don't have a foundation of friendship with my spouse? And what did that look like?
We didn't like each other very much at one point.
Yeah, I think, you know, just like you said, you get so caught up in all of the demands and the things that are happening. You shift your focus from being a young married couple who are very good friends to suddenly everything shifts to care of the kids, care of parents, care of your career, all of these other things. And the friendship slowly becomes the last thing that you get to mm-hmm. because everything else feels important. And so we stopped dating.
Yeah.
We stopped having time for ourselves. When we would go out to parties, we always had kids with us, you know, and it just, mm-hmm. the opportunities to continue to build our friendship became less and less and less.
Yeah.
And so we had to decide that in order for everything else to flourish, we have to redevelop our friendship. And find ways to build that again. And it just has fed into all of the other areas of our lives.
What have you found to be the best way to do that? I mean, what comes to my mind is spending time together. Mm-hmm. It's kind of simple, but yeah. when you got married for a reason, you mm-hmm. were attracted to each other, you loved each other, you said yeah. yes, mm-hmm. and then you get busy with the distractions you identified. But the best remedy for not feeling that friendship is rekindle the friendship, spend time together, do things together. Is that fair?
Yes, absolutely. We are firm believers that you have to set aside time. And it yeah. doesn't have to be a big weekend away or mm-hmm. a big crazy steak dinner. It can be coffee. It
right.
can be an
yes.
hour.
Time together.
It yes. can be an hour at Starbucks just to say, how are you? And have a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
And it's amazing what that hour can do. Every week.
Yeah. Let me ask you this for the wife. Just picture someone in your mind, a wife or husband, who's saying, I hear what you guys are talking about, but I don't feel like my spouse wants friendship yeah. with me. What recommendation do you have to that yes. desert feeling that yeah. I'm not getting any response and maybe
That's
they're
important.
Using the mm-hmm. wrong tactics that might right? be, but what yeah. what would you say that individual says, yeah. I'm in trouble?
Well, when you get to the point where you don't really like each other because the friendship has faded, mm-hmm. it's difficult to have the emotional energy to want to even be together in those kinds of moments. So Guy and I, early on in one of those early conversations we had, was we need to simply fake it till we make it for a little bit, because we know that putting in place some time for one another and to do things that we used to do that we no longer do that were fun for us together, we have to start putting those things back in place and trust the process that we are going to rekindle those emotions and feelings of friendship at some point.
And it's really important. I want to punch mm-hmm. that a little bit, because what you're saying is go through the motions when you don't
yes.
feel it.
That's
because
right.
your feelings will catch up with the right actions.
That's right. Because
it's not lying, or it's just doing the right thing.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah. we do a lot of parenting ministry, and one of the things I tell moms and dads, like, if you're having a rough day, just stop and smile. Just start smiling. You know, if the kids are getting to you, whatever, it, just stop and smile. Just the act of smiling, it scientifically, you can read the research
right.
reports, but it has an impact on your thinking, on your mindset. And it's the same. Like, even if it's something new that you're trying together, you know, find
yeah.
some common ground that you both is new territory for
yeah.
both of you even.
Right.
But make that time, be purposeful, be intentional. And Guy and I also got really structured in our calendar. You know, mm-hmm. if you feel like life has a chokehold on you, your schedule has a chokehold on you, then you have to remove that chokehold in very purposeful ways. We're intentional to plan downtime in our calendar, where we have time where it's just mm-hmm. nothing is planned, and we don't let anything encroach on that, so we can just relax at home even and not have something to do all the time.
That's important.
But also, you know, we color code our calendar. You know, here's things for the kids, here's things for homeschool, here's things for work.
Wow,
but
that is organized.
I know.
That's
the planning thing. That's me.
We run three businesses. We homeschool.
Yeah.
We do everything together. So we're not talking about like I work and she's at home. We both have crazy, crazy schedules like a lot
yeah.
of you guys
nowadays,
do. So it's a challenge.
Yeah, and I hear that. And that applies then. If you guys can do it, others can do it.
Yeah.
That's
true.
The point.
Yes, true.
Let me go to the spiritual side of this in the last few minutes that we have here. This is one of the big triggers, and we hear from couples, a lot of wives, to disclaim mm-hmm. that. But they feel like their husbands aren't leading. They're not taking that spiritual leadership role,
yes.
and it's frustrating. And the wife is, you know, it's hard to not have some expectations.
It is. Yes.
And so I guess that would be the question. Mm-hmm. What do you say to that spouse who is struggling with, that wife who's struggling with the lack of her husband doing what he should be doing to be the spiritual leader of the home?
Yeah, that lack of spiritual leadership issue is one that I had no idea was so common until I started being transparent about that in our own marriage.
Then you found out just about everybody struggles with
A lot of people struggle with that. And so I got really caught up in what my kind of growing up mindset of what a spiritual leader would look like, and then really was putting that on Guy. And, you know, Guy is on his own spiritual path, and so am I. And so we had to allow room for one another to be who we are in Christ and for the Holy Spirit to work on us. So it didn't mean that we couldn't have conversations about that, but we're supposed to spur one another on toward love and good deeds. It didn't say nag him to death because he doesn't lead a Bible study over dinner every night. You know, this expectation that I had that he was going to come in, spiritual leadership looks like him picking the Bible verse for the month that our kids are going to memorize, and he's going to come up with a cool song so they memorize it, because that was what I liked to do. That was my strength. And so I just put that on Guy.
That's
like,
right.
Why aren't you doing this? And so I became very judgmental of him, and that's not a good place to be in a marriage.
Well, and I entered our relationship feeling this way because Amber, we both have grown up in Christian homes, but Amber, you know, literally studied, you know.
She took it seriously.
Yeah, took it very seriously.
I went to Bible college. I have a minor in theology.
We had very different experiences, and so my faith, I think, tends to come out a little bit more in when I'm with the kids hiking and I can make things very real to them spiritually, or when I can have conversations with them on a one-to-one basis. I may not sit down and have the family Bible study, but I pour into them in the way that I can connect with them. And it's a very different way.
Did you feel that pressure coming from Amber?
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Well, without a doubt.
Expectation.
But I never felt like I could ever do that, because I always felt like she would criticize me, or I can never do the right thing, or I'm going to do the wrong verse. I literally went into it like
this. This may be the 80-20 rule. I think 80-90% of us husbands feel this. Mm-hmm. I know for Jean and I, that was it. She did, I think, speak to this, but being a biology major, I mean, she wanted a very traditional devotion with the family after dinner.
Yeah.
And I'm like, we have two boys.
Yeah.
If we had daughters, that might work.
Maybe.
But two boys, we got to go out in the backyard, roll around. And then when they hurt me, I'm going to say, you remember King Saul? And that really was my approach to integrating faith into everyday life.
Yeah,
and I think that is typical of husbands, where we're looking for, like, driving them to school. We talk about Proverbs.
Yeah.
I'd have them read a proverb as I was taking them to school.
Right.
But Jean wasn't seeing that.
Yes.
And I think, you know, it gave her the sense that I never talk about the Lord with the boys. And that wasn't accurate.
And it is judgmental. Mm-hmm. Amber, you use that. It is
better
judgmental.
Better you say that than me.
It is. That is. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And that to think that we have it all right.
Right.
That we know exactly how it should be done, sitting down with that devotion.
But let me come to your rescue for a minute, because one of the things I've noticed with moms particularly, there is a fear and control component. We're in a very difficult culture where the culture is grabbing our kids.
Right.
And telling them, you know, about sex and about other things. And it scares us.
Yes, that's right.
And I think moms particularly really deeply feel that threat. And so they want an antidote. They want, if they're going to give our children this, we got to give them that. And that's absolutely true. And so I think it's born out of a good place to compensate for the messaging that kids are receiving in the culture.
It is. Our hearts are in the right place.
Yeah, and we just have to figure out how we do that effectively, because if you're wagging your finger at your kids, that's not going to work.
And it's really about letting each person's spiritual strengths be their spiritual strengths. You know, we have different personalities, and because we're on different spiritual levels of maturity, just naturally you're two different people, it was really important for me to come to a place where I didn't have to live in fear that my kids were going to be sucked into culture or other influences. And if I had continued to place my expectation of what spiritual leadership should look like on him, we would all be missing out.
No, and I so appreciate that. And that's a good word for, again, I think moms particularly who do have those concerns. I mean, husbands aren't off the hook. Don't get that message
Correct.
Here.
Yeah,
we've got absolutely. To be engaged. We need to be engaged. You need to be dad.
That's right.
And talk about the Lord in those contexts that fit you and amplify the Lord's work in your own life.
Right.
We are right near the end, Amber and Guy, and we've taken a mostly lighthearted approach to these things, but there's been depth to what we've talked about. I always say, you know, it's hard to cover all the content in this great book. People just need to get the book, and they can read it and highlight it and underline it. But there was a night, and I want to make sure we capture this, there was a night when your fighting got so bad, and some couples are going to identify with this because they're there right now. But you, Amber, considered leaving your marriage. What happened that night, and what helped you to turn the corner, the two of you?
Well, I recognized that I would give up every personal happiness for the sake of my kids. Like, I would have stayed in my marriage unhappy just to try to give my kids some semblance of security. But that wasn't really working, because I remember very distinctly the Lord speaking to my heart and saying, I am not creating you to settle for less than God's best, for less than my best for you. I did not design or bring you together to just navigate through life and soldier through and try to keep peace that's a false peace by just not arguing anymore. I came to give life to the full, you know, Jesus says. And so I recognized that I could not at that point allow Satan to win and to fracture us and to overtake us by our triggers. And so I just came to the point of great humility of saying, Lord, and it was totally the Lord, because when you're at that point and you just think that it's hopeless, it's a very dark place to be. But because we had children, and I think a lot of couples feel this way, they want to keep that marriage intact.
Absolutely.
And so I just made a decision. And actually, I remembered our wedding vows. Guy and I said on the day that we got married, and people kind of guffawed at the thought of what we were saying, but we said out loud to each other, I will not divorce you. And so we'd said that because we knew that there would be challenges.
Yes.
And we wanted to hear it. And really, the fact that we had said that, and I think a lot of couples obviously are that's the intention when you get married, is that you'll till death do us part. But we wanted to say it out loud so that when those nights come, like the one where I wanted to just go, we would remember what we said and continue to fight for one another.
Yeah.
As opposed to with each other. Because if we're so busy fighting each other, we are powerless to fight the good fight, to fight the better fight. And that's what I realized. I realized that if I walked away today, I will not be fighting the good fight anymore with him. And God can make a way. If he is the God of yesterday, today, and forever, and he is unchanging, then there's nothing that's impossible with him, and he can bring us back together again. And he has. When you come to that point, we really are prayerful that you will consider that your triggers are not the end of your story, and that there is an opportunity for hope and for growth. And we're living proof of that,
yeah.
Really.
Guy, your perspective on that.
Yeah, I just totally agree. Amber made a comment one time about there is nothing that anger can do that love cannot do better. Yeah. And for me, that really has settled, you know, for me in those moments when I'm feeling anger. It just pops into my mind, and I just remember this is not what the Lord has in store for me, and I control the ship, and I have to make a decision right here to love her better, even if it's not what I want in this moment, because I know that that's what's best.
And that'll bring this best of 2021 Focus on the Family conversation to a close, featuring Guy and Amber Lia and Gene Daly as well.
Well, it's easy to understand why this was one of our top programs of the year. Amber and Guy had such great insight and practical wisdom for working through some of the little things in marriage that get under our skin. And you know, here at Focus on the Family, we care about your marriage. We work tirelessly to highlight content like this so you can have a healthy, thriving connection with your spouse.
And we also have our Hope Restored Marriage Intensives for couples who need more intervention and help with their relationship.
Hope Restored does such a great job for broken marriages. Some couples report the intensive was like a year's worth of counseling. And we follow up with the folks who attend, and after 2 years, 81% of the couples have a better relationship and stronger satisfaction in their marriage. I love the work that's going on at Hope Restored. But if you're not in a spot of brokenness, we have many other resources to help strengthen your marriage. Guy and Amber's book, Marriage Triggers, is a great place to start. And you can get that through Focus on the Family. And when you do, those proceeds go right back into ministry, giving families hope every day.
And thousands of people reach out to Focus on the Family for help by phone, mail, and email. In fact, we recently heard from a gentleman named Brian who told us he used to be an angry person, but he started listening to and watching Focus on the Family, and his heart changed, and his marriage got better. He said he's so thankful for Focus on the Family and all we're doing to help families and marriages.
I love hearing comments like that, but let's face it, that's the work of the Lord in your life. And we never want to turn anyone away. But in order to continue cooperating with the Holy Spirit and helping people like Brian, we need your help, especially here as we're heading toward Christmas and the end of the year. God can use your support to provide scripture-based resources and programs to save and strengthen families. And when you give a gift of any amount today, we'll send you a copy of Marriage Triggers as our way of saying thank you. Your support is critical so that we can finish the year strong and plan to reach even more families in the coming year. God's going to do some great things through you and Focus on the Family in 2022.
Donate today and get your copy of Marriage Triggers when you call 800, the letter A and the word family, or click the link below. And on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, I'm John Fuller, thanking you for joining us today for Focus on the Family and inviting you back next time as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.